Hi, it's your local dragon lady here, and I'm going to start this video off by saying happy birthday to my husband, the completionist. He works across the country to make sure that we and our cats have a roof over our head and that we can continue to play children's card games. Yeah. But for his birthday, he asked that I make a video talking about troll decks. I am no stranger to the troll deck. On this channel, I've made Banished Stall deck and a Somochi Nurse Burn. Both profiles I'll have links into the description below. But I'm no stranger to this in Duel Links either. My most notables would be the Amulet of Ambition and Somochi decks. The idea of a troll deck is nothing new. In fact, if you go to your locals, there's always that one person who always does it. But it's something that's always existed even in the earlier days. While it wasn't necessarily known as trolling at the time, there were cards and strategies that people used to either annoy their opponent into submission or just waste their time. These can range to simple stalls like having a monster with ridiculously high defense points just sit there with an Imperial Order up so your opponent can't destroy with any magic, to the emerging burn mill cards. While not a big deal today, they had their impact during the early days of Yu-Gi-Oh! For the mill deck, you had cards like Needleworm, Cyberjar, and Card Destruction. Even if you did not deck out, losing a bunch of your cards without any way to recover them would often lead to a scoop. For Burn, we had Hinotama, Tremendous Fire, Just Desserts, and so forth. Burn did not have a lot of options back then, however, you could be more creative by adding Bat Reaction or Fire Princess to your deck and run cards that heal both yourself and your opponent. These cards on their own were just padding added to conventional decks to simply act as a disruptor, but later, stall cards were introduced and these were what gave Burn and Mill their viability, and they became their own decks entirely. But by taking these stall cards and bundling them together, you could build a deck that's sole purpose was to make your opponent cry. And I think old school Yu-Gi-Oh! Was the golden age of the emerging troll deck. These were cards like Stumbling, Gravity Bind, and Level Limit Area B. There were no XC or Link monsters in those days, and monster effects that prevented these cards were uncommon, so you really had to rely on removal cards like MSD or Heavy Storm to deal with these obstacles, and Beatdown being the most common meta at the time, these stall strategies were a pain to play through. Everything changed, however, with the release of Legacy of Darkness in 2003. This introduced the concept of lockout decks. Decks that, if played right, could lock your opponent from playing the game altogether. And the card that made this possible was a little raven of all things, Yatagatasu, and he introduced what was called the Yatalock. The idea of locking out was niche at first, and it began to fit into the troll category. So during the time of Yatagatasu's release, nobody really batted an eye to this card because of its low attack power. But it did not take long to figure out its true power. The Yatalock was mostly made possible with another card released in a later set, the Chaos Emperor Dragon. The most common version of the strategy is this. If you have either a Sangan or Witch of the Black Forest on the field, special summon Chaos Emperor Dragon. With cards like Painful Choice, this wasn't especially hard to do. Use Chaos Emperor's effect to nuke the board. Then, if you use Sangan or Witch's effect to search out a Garasu, summon and presto. You can then have Yata attack your opponent directly and they then skip their draw phase. This broke the game so much that a ban list had to be introduced. That's right, up until 2004, there was no ban list. We had a limited list. Fun times! But the lockout deck still technically exists, but the term has been disguised. Today is now called the dice roll format. Today, Yu-Gi-Oh! Has come to the point in which the person who goes first can set up their board that prevents their opponent from playing or performing an FTK. I've done this, but we'll get to that in a bit. Today, some of the decks are capable of blocking out their opponent or in the current meta, but they also exhibit many of the same traits that troll decks did from back in the day. We now have the ability to set up so many restrictions against our opponents that, in many cases, they can't even play. To me, a game that only takes one player into consideration just isn't right. And during 2004, Konami acknowledged this and created a ban list for official tournaments. But after releasing more and more cards with negate effects and game restrictions, it's led up to the current state of the negate boards, FTKs, and lockdowns. Not being able to have a draw phase was one thing, but not being able to play despite being able to draw a card? That's almost worse. I remember the Yada Lock. I was there. And as nasty as it was, I have been able to get out of it. Not all the time, mind you, but I have pulled it off. Today, with a board with 3+ negates, even with a raw sphere mode, that scenario can be more challenging sometimes. And this was a question I had when I got back into the game in 2018. If dueling restrictions like these were not okay years ago, why is it now? How is it that what was considered trolly back then is now considered normal gameplay today? I think it could be due to the cause and effect. Konami has to keep making new cards to keep the business going. So when a supposed broken card is released, there are often two responses to it. Either ban or limit the card, or make a new card that can combat its effects. To keep the game diverse, new forms of summoning were added. Synchro, XZ, then it really went off the edge with Pendulums and Lynx. There's still a debate if the last two were healthy for the game or not. Naturally, with so many cards out there with so many effects, it was a matter of time that game-breaking combos would be discovered, and this led to the cycle being repeated. Ban or limit the culprit, or keep making new cards to combat it. It just got out of control, but that's the basics of how the game evolved to its current form. If you were to make a normal gameplay deck like anything that involves, I don't know, Guard Dragons, and brought it back to the early 2000s, they'd probably say, yeah, you're trolling. Changes like this were gradual, and so were opinions. Duelists who continued to play the game up until now just accepted it as an evolution of the game, and probably did not even notice it. Take this for example. When I came back into the game from a 14-year hiatus, the first deck I faced was Burning Abyss. I thought it was really neat, and that match went to Game 3. But my second match, however, was against Flower Guardians, and that's what woke me up to the new realities of the game. So I knew that I had to undergo some massive changes myself. The line of what I thought was troll was getting blurred, but there were three types that still seemed to fit into the trolling category as I played on. Burn, Mill, and Lockdown. So let's get back to my Lockdown and FTK burn decks. When it came to FTK, I'd done this numerous times with my Somogyi Nurse burn deck. With high-hitting cards like Try and Guess, Gift Card, and Path of Destiny, all you need is the ability to go first, and you can burn your opponent to the ground on their standby phase, thus preventing them from even playing at all. As for Lockdown, Mystic Mine! Yes, I went there, and yes, the reaction I got was, how should I put this? Neat. Plenty scoops of ice cream were served that day, I will say. One deck I think that annoys my locals the most will be the Inferno Tempest deck. That one card alone promises the return of the priceless reaction of your opponent having to separate all their monsters from their deck and graveyard. And this is what brings me to the original point of this video. Given the severe restrictions and crazy methods that these decks impose, why do some of us still play them? They are easy to hate after all, because they often derail the strategy that people build their decks around, and troll decks are pretty difficult to maneuver around to begin with. With the number of duelists who do play with these types of decks, I think the reason is simple: to cause frustration, to show that it only takes a few cards to make a meta deck crash and burn. It also displays an element of surprise. Watching your opponent react to such an obscure yet powerful card is sometimes the reason troll duelists play the cards that they do. But in my case, it's a little different. If you see my burn deck profile, you will notice that the build greatly resembles a deck that could have been played during the first generation of the game. So much so that if you only played Yu-Gi-Oh! In the first few years of its release, you can pick up this deck, give it a quick look, and take it to competition right away. Easy peasy. The deck is so simple and straightforward, like how it was in the old days, and the fact that it can take down the modern decks of today just goes to show that older methods of play should not be disregarded. This is also partially the reason why I love Chaos Max and other ritual decks. They stay true to my first generation duel style, and they can still stand on their own. It's my way of saying, I may be old, but I still got it. Mystic Mind, however, is a bit of a different story. That deck is still simple, and also plays like an old school deck, however, it has the lockdown mechanic. Like the Yata Lock, it is a challenge, but not impossible to overcome. But the reaction to the card's existence was massive, and entire videos were devoted to the creation and the destruction of this deck. By the way, I made my own video about the release of this card, so you can find that link in the description below. Now, the reason I play Mystic Mind is simply because I grew tired of the negate boards that is taking over the meta, a format that a dice roll really does decide whether you win or get to play at all. Duelists from all over were crying that Mystic Mind will prevent people from playing the game, and I responded, well, so does negate boards. Mystic Mind, when you think about it, does the exact same thing what negate boards do. It just does it faster with less effort. So yes, I built the Chain Burn version of Mystic Mind to simply emphasize the point I was making on this problem, that none of this was fair. While I do love the fact that Konami has been releasing cards to combat the negate board issue, it was their fault for allowing Yu-Gi-Oh! To reach this state to begin with. Remember, the game was still fairly young when Yata Garasu came out, a lock that was still possible before the release of Invasion of Chaos. If Konami messed it up years ago, then what's going on right now is no real surprise. I've had heard some people say that maybe duelists should simply not use so many of these cards that prevents their opponent from playing, but at the same time, how is that fair either? If the card exists and is legal, gamers should be allowed to play whatever they want, especially if they're in it to win, which most competitors are. What I'm trying to say is that yes, while it does suck that decks like these do exist, the onus should not be on the player for the current condition of the game. Konami themselves have resisted to banning Fireball Dragon for so long that it took duelists at the 200th YCS to demonstrate to Konami employees the problem that card caused. It should not come to that. Good duelists recognize what cards are causing problems and even advocate for their banning, even if that card gives them an advantage in competition. While the past few ban lists have been positive for the game, I'd like to think that Konami is paying attention, but who knows at this point, especially considering that Cyberstein is now semi-limited in the OCG. So what kind of a duelist are you? Are you casual, meta, or are you that one person at your locals who just wants to troll everyone? Let me know in the comments below. But regardless of what deck or style you play, always be a good sport. Play the game, not the fame. See ya! Thanks for watching! If you like what you see, subscribe and be sure to click on the bell for notifications. You can also check me out on Facebook. The link is in the description below. Happy dueling!